Amen.
Take your miracle seat and put your hands together for Jesus. Now, this is the part two or the second part of the message I began last Thursday. Amen.
Amen.
I started teaching on the call of God on your life as an individual or as a church. Last week Sunday, I explained to the whole church, those who were part of the Sunday service, that our lives on earth is to serve a divine assignment. And we are here because God's destiny is calling on us. We are here because we must fulfill a divine purpose before we exit into eternity. And as a pastor, my mission is to help you discover and to step into the fullness of that call. So last Thursday evening, I shared a few things about the call of God. That the source of the call is from God. Every calling, every profession, every work that you have to do on earth, that is not directly or indirectly coming from God. If it is not a direct call or indirect call from God, it may not receive divine attention. So whatever we may be doing on earth, as we come to the end of this age, you and I must begin to examine, re-examine, and cross-examine. To know that as a child of God, as a man, as a woman, the call on my life, is it given or was it from God or it was by man? God went to Samuel and called him three times. And there are a lot of people sitting under the sound of my voice that God's call is on your life. And you need to respond to the call like Samuel responded to his call. I said again that the strength of the call is the Holy Spirit. When God calls you, he empowers you for his calling. Whatever God called you to do and has called you to do, there is a strength attached to that call. I said there is strength attached to the call of God. There is power attached to the call of God. You may be looking at the wrong things in life, but the moment you start focusing on the call of God on your life, I can bet you with my faith that things will work together for good. For the scripture says, all things work together for good to them who love God and are called according to his purpose. So things will work out for your good if only you respond to the call of God. Tell your neighbor there is power and strength for the call of God. Then number three, I said you must know the purpose and the sphere of the call. And I said five types of things that God gives to those who respond to his call. I said that number one, the call of God is to give you rest. The call of God is to give you rest. The call of God is to give you rest. I said the call of God is to give you rest. Matthew 11:28, come to me all you that labor and are heavily laden and I will give you rest. Take me back to the scripture. Don't project what I have not called for. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavily laden, and I will give you rest. Verse 29. I hope you can put 28 and 29 together. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we rise to the reading of his word?
Take it again.
May the whole congregation respond as you.
Amen.
Put your hands together and take your miracles. So from this scripture, I showed you that when God calls you, he wants to give you rest. And I shared five types of rest that we receive from God. Is it seven types of rest? Can you project it quickly for me? That number one, when you receive, you respond to the call of God. When you come to Christ as a son of God, as a daughter of God, as a child of God, and when you become born again into the church of Christ, God rests your life, or he delivers you from the bondage of Egypt. Then he gives you rest from the bondage of sin and death. Three, he gives you rest from the curse of fruitless labor. Fourthly, he gives you rest from the power of addiction. The fifth is to receive rest from the curse of this world and deceitfulness of riches. And the sixth one is to give you rest from eternal punishment. And the seventh one is to give you rest in heaven after death. Put your hands together. If you respond to the call of God, these rests are your possessions. These rests are there for you. He delivers you and he gives you rest. Number two, when God calls you, go back to Matthew 11:29. And that is what I want to teach from today. Matthew 11:29. Now he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavily laden, and I'll give you rest. Can we read from the next part? Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your soul. This morning I'm teaching on take taking his yoke upon yourself.
First
one is a call to receive rest from God. Second one is to take his yoke upon yourself. When you become a child of God, when you come to Christ and you are born again, there is salvation and freedom for you. But after you receive that salvation and freedom, there is an exchange trade that goes on. God says, now I want you to take upon yourself my yoke. In other words, you had a yoke of your own that you could not bear. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavily laden. Meaning that there is a yoke that you are bearing, and there's a yoke that you alone cannot bear it. It's a yoke from this world. It could be a yoke from the problems you encounter in this world. The cares of this world and the deceitfulness of this world's riches. The troubles that happen to humanity on earth. But when you come to God, he says, I want to give you rest. Then I will take away your yoke and give you my yoke. So you see an exchange trade happening between you and God. You see, in our days and in this dispensation, a lot of messages and preachings that go on in churches, most of the preachings and the messages do not address the fact that when we come to Christ, we must be ready to bear his yoke. It is a message only about the first part. Come to God for rest. Come to God for breakthroughs. Come to God for miracles. Come to God for healing. Come to God for your marital breakthrough. Come to God and all your family members will die, leaving you. As God should be killing all our family members who bear witnesses to the grace of God on your life. If God should be killing all our family members, where and when are you going to witness to people to go to heaven? Let's imagine that you pray for God to kill all your family members. Then the next neighbor, God kills all his family members. Then the other person by you, God kills all his family members. How would the world be like? You are a family member to another person's family. So before you realize, another person's prayer might have knocked you down and you go out of this world. I don't know if you are catching the revelation. Praise the living God, church.
Hallelujah.
So it is good to pray against the enemies, but we must employ wisdom, because the call of God is not only to give you rest. It is a call to take upon yourself the yoke of Christ. Somebody must be prepared to take upon him or herself the year 2018, the yoke of our Savior Jesus Christ. I said you must be prepared to take upon yourself the yoke of Christ. I am sharing with you that we have not been called to a yokeless Christianity. That when you become born again and you come to Christ, you are free. There is no yoke, there is no burden to carry.
Oh,
it's a call to carry the burden of the Lord. I said, it's a call to carry the burden of the Lord. It is a call to carry the desires of God. It is a call to showcase to the whole world the things God has designed for his children. And I want to help you as a preacher sent from heaven. For you to identify your yoke and start carrying it. Your amen is looking for my trouble this morning. Go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14.
2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14.
The writings of Paul, 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14. My guy should be so smart. You have everything with you. Can we read? Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Can we read that first part? Church, lift up your heads and read. One to go. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness?
Amen.
You didn't respond properly. Take the reading again. Some of them were not listening.
Poor woman, a tossum in Rotokoma Colonto. A tinsia in Muduna and say, Money one and one in the entry conia crow. Track a band at Tenene, ne Mumuyo, and as a young for band and hiney a sum ewo. Amen.
So this scripture clearly shows us two kinds of yokes.
And Tisatrosum were Edisrey and Conia Milu.
The yoke for the unbeliever and the yoke for the believer. So even people who are in the world, they are under a certain yoke. Those who are in the world and they are not in this kingdom, they walk under a certain yoke. But when you come to Jesus, he takes away the yoke of the world so that you can bear his yoke. And so the scripture says, do not unequally yoke. Do not. Don't yoke. Don't have things in common with people who are not for Christ. I see a lot of business people. I see a lot of church members. I see a lot of people who are into trading. And their business partners or their trading partners, they are unbelievers and they schedule to work on Sundays and it's agreed. There are people who go to work on Sundays just because it's a day that you can also make money. Tell me that a Muslim will stop going to the mosque and come and transact business with you on Fridays. Tell me, church, lift up your heads and let's be truthful to ourselves. A Muslim will not leave the salah is to perform at the mosque and come and transact business. One day I happened to go to a certain office and the officer there was a Muslim. When I entered the place, there was a small queue. So I needed to join the queue so that when it gets to my turn, I enter the office and present my petition. I think about 2 to 3 people before I entered the office, I saw the man come out of the office and locked it. So I was like, but where is this man going? Somebody tapped me and said, he's a Muslim, he's going to perform salah. What? So I should be wasting my time while he's praying. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
You see the wisdom of other religious folks. He closes the office irrespective of your status, your social pedigree. He closes the office because the duty of religion is at the back of his calling. There are most of you here. When your personal agenda clashes with eternal purposes. You skip the eternal purposes and you attend to personal agendas.
And I said, "Dear, I mean, it's with them. I mean, they are not
when it's time for church, and it's Tuesday, you tell me that no, Pastor, this Tuesday, I wish I could come, but you know, I have to go and make money."
A bit more while I was say, "A deb, not a mumba, sorry, no, 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 I said, 'Dear, dear, so soft for me, come here, banana, so some yam,
maybe you don't know, and you are not aware. The fastest growing religion in our season is Islam.
See, and yeah, pray so as soon as it's too pompa and cremosome.
Take it from me as a pastor.
See,
the fastest growing religion is not Christianity again. Because Muslims will never go to the mosque and sleep.
If we send cremophore and quan cremodam and
but Christians go to church and they sleep. And so we can't grow and advance the kingdom.
The
fastest growing religion is what? It's not Christianity again. Because we have chosen the first part of the call. Come to me and I'll give you rest. So all we
want
to do is to rest. Even the prayer points we release on radio stations, on televisions, you visit other prayer camps, look at the content of the prayers they pray. It's all about give me for rest, give me rest, give me rest. God, give me rest, give me and my marriage rest, give me and my children rest, give me and everything. It's rest, 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 and we are resting. We are not ready to move. We are not ready to arise. We are not ready to respond to the second part of the call. And so the growth of Christianity is now at a low degree. The numerical strength of the church is gradually deteriorating. Now we mostly blame the devil and his cohort for hell. Church, listen to me. It is not all about the devil. We have become lazy Christians. Look at me. We have become what? Lazy Christians. Responding to the yoke of the call, we said no. But may God help us. May God help us to be readily available. To be readily prepared. Go with me to Ezekiel 22. And verse 30. Ezekiel 22 and verse 30. 22:30. So I sought for a man among them who will make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found no one. I sought for a man among them. I sought for a man among them. I sought for a woman among them. I sought for a boy among them. I sought for a young lady among them. That should make up the hedge. That should make up the hedge. That should stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found none. May God find somebody this morning. Building or hedging something calls for hard work. And God's call to us as a church is to build a hedge of salvation. God's call to us as a church is to stand in the gap for other people. God's call to us as a church is to do the work of his ministry. And I need somebody's heart to be prepared enough. I need the desires of people to change. I need the attention of people to be shifted from responding to the call of humanity. Let's start responding to the call of divinity. Now, the call of God or the yoke of Christ is the yoke of his kingdom. What did I say? The yoke of Christ is the yoke of his kingdom. The yoke of Christ is a shared yoke. I'm saying the yoke of Christ is what? The yoke of his kingdom. And the yoke of Christ is a shared yoke. Now, what do I mean by the yoke of his kingdom and a shared yoke?
So Africa said, Osoro,
let me illustrate it this way. When you are a worker and you work with somebody or you work under somebody, the moment you are enrolled into that business, the yoke of the CEO becomes your yoke. Is it true or false? When you are enrolled into a business, in other words, the vision of the CEO becomes your vision. You're going to channel all energy and efforts to ensure the fulfillment of the vision. So the yoke of Christ is the yoke of his kingdom. And the yoke of Christ is a shared yoke. Now look at me. In the days of Jesus, two animals were put there and there was a rope or a yoke that was passed across these two animals. One animal on my left, the other animal on my right. Then there's something that unifies them. A yoke puts the two animals together. And there will be a wooden object behind these two animals, such that the two animals, the moment they move away, they will carry the yoke that is placed upon them. And the yoke was to carry loads and other things. Listen to me, church. The yoke of Christ is a shared yoke. What I mean is that God did not call you alone to suffer. Any sufferings we suffer for his kingdom, we suffer together with Christ. Any sufferings we go through, we go through the sufferings with Christ. Now, in Mark chapter 16, and verse 17, 18 thereabout, kindly go with me to Mark chapter 16. Let's read from verse 20. Mark 16:20. And he says, can we read? And they went forth and preached everywhere. Read. The Lord working with who? With them. And confirming the words with signs following. So God was working with them. The yoke of Christ is a shared yoke. There is nobody to usher the people. I don't want the way people are moving out and in. I don't like it. When I'm preaching, you need to sit down and listen to your pastor's preaching. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Sit down and listen to your pastor's preaching. It's not a good habit. Praise God. I need your voice. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So I'm saying that the yoke of Christ is what? Is what? We have been called to share the burden of the Lord. Whatever God wants you to do, he is with you to finish it. Whatever assignment God has for our lives, he is with us to finish it. He says, behold, I am with you till the end of the age. So you must master courage and respond to the call of God. Because he says again, when you go through the waters, it will never drown you. When you pass through fire, you will never be burned. I am with you in the fire and I'm with you in the waters. When Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego found themselves in the furnace of fire, there was a fourth man in the fire. The yoke of Christ is a shared yoke. And we must not be afraid of the witches. We must not be afraid with the powers of darkness. We must not be afraid of occultic powers. powers, irrespective of the magnitude and the force of that power, we are working with a master who is superior in power. We are working with a savior who is majestic in power. If only we can see him with our eyes of faith, that I am not alone on this earth. The assignment God has for my life, he is with me to accomplish it. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I want to briefly talk about now the yoke of Christ means to embrace the doctrines of Christ. The yoke of Christ is what? Say the doctrines of Christ. Church, talk with me. The doctrines of Christ. No, you can't be here and when your pastor says do this and you are not listening. The yoke of Christ means what? You are embracing the doctrines. And the word doctrines means teachings of Christ. I wonder what some of the mothers, what you are doing is not the best. I see you and I have to address it. By the time you leave, nothing has entered your head.
I will find more need you so.
Your child is not far more important than God. God is the giver of the child. And God cares more, he cares far more than you care for your child.
Go
with the child all day long in your house. Come to church and pay attention to the word of God. Excuse me for my language and don't deceive yourself. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
So the yoke of Christ is what? The doctrines and the teachings of Christ. You must be ready to receive the teachings of Christ. We have traditional teachings. Teachings we have acquired from our homes. Teachings that have been passed on orally by our predecessors, grandparents and grandfathers. Things that are organizing and directing our lives. But the foundation of those teachings are not of God. Let me give you an example. The tradition of this community or the tradition of Africa is that before a man and a woman gets married and they are wedded, the woman has the right to go and sleep with the man. Listen to me and look at me, everybody. I'm preaching to you. I'm looking at you, so you need to look at me. So before a man marries a woman, the woman should be cooking for the man, and then in the evening he goes to sleep. He will say, you sleep at the back of the man. Then after some time, the man gathers money, go and offer or pay the bride price. This very tradition is devilish. But it's being practiced even by Christians. You see somebody who prays in tongues, but in the night season, there's somebody at his back. He will tell you that, oh, when you have one, it's nothing. Bear the yoke of Christ, the teachings of Christ. The yoke of Christ should be a yoke upon you, the teachings of Christ. Yeah, I know you will not listen to me because I'm not releasing powerful blessings on your destinies. Because I'm not prophesying that may you grow old. I'm not prophesying that may so and so happen to you. I'm not prophesying that may all your enemies die. I'm saying that there is a yoke you must bear. And it is the yoke of the teachings of Christ. It is so amazing when Jesus came and he was teaching. Jesus says that he who sees a woman and lusts after her, has already committed fornication in the house. This is too powerful and too strange. Just looking at a woman and observing the way she walks. As the woman is taking steps, then the man gazes the two optical balls. You gaze at the woman as she takes steps. You look at the panties and the dresses. You look at the way the buttons are shaking. And something is ringing and something is triggering on your inside. Scripture says you have already committed fornication. Bear the yoke of Christ. So when we talk about fornicators in church, we are not referring to those who are practically demonstrating it. But you can sin in your thoughts when you gaze something and you lust after it.
We
live in a society that agrees to everything that will enhance the dignity of man. But we don't consider the scriptural perspective of that thing. And I am warning you as a servant sent from God. The yoke of Christ is the teachings of Christ. You can't be a member of this church, sit under the anointed ministration of your pastor. You have a boyfriend, you have a girlfriend. When is the night season? The two of you are sleeping and committing things married people do.
Come
to church and you start ratakata riatakapa. But in the ninth season, all your tongues evaporated. In the ninth season, you forgot that you were a Christian. Some church leaders, they do, and some pastors do. God forbid, and over my dead body. I will not do that, so I will not allow my children to do it. I will discipline you severely when you are caught. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
You see, we respond to the first part of the call. I have come to God. There is rest. Oh, there's liberty in Christ. Yes, I love you with the love of the Lord. Yes, I love you with the love of the Lord. The love of God does not take people to bed. The love of God does not give money to people and expect something in return. What kind of love is when you receive something is being demanded? We must question the integrity of that love. May we be genuinely filled with the love of God. It is a love that tells your brother, your sister, I give this car to you, I don't demand anything from you. It's a love that tells a brother, a sister, I give you this clothes, I don't demand anything from you. It is a love that says that, Mama, I've been praying for you, I don't need anything from you. I'm talking about the time where the church gets to the dimension where the love of God begins to manifest.
Amen.
We begin to practicalize the teachings of Christ.
Amen.
We don't walk according to the traditions of our day. Go to churches and singers and choristers. They are like dogs who roam about in the night seasons. Pastors fear to talk about them because they will run away and leave the church. For 5 years now, I am a pianist, I am a preacher, I am a singer, I am a prayer warrior, I am everything. Apostle Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And this year, by the grace of God, this church will start double service. I'm saying it to the shame of the devil. Most of you are not prepared for that, but I and God, we are enough to start it. When I come and there's no singer, I'll pick the microphone and sing. When I come and there's nobody, I'll pick the microphone and lead prayer. I want somebody to understand. You are here to carry the yoke, the teachings of Christ. The teachings of Christ. Not the traditions of your forefathers. Not the traditions of your grandparents. Sit there in your sin and be telling me, Pastor, these things are difficult to talk about. You know, by grace we are saved and not by works. Apostle Paul says, shall we continue sinning because grace may abound
unto
us. He gave a quick response. Emphatically, he said,
no.
No, we must not continue to say. For grace to abound unto us. You may never love me because of the way I preach to you. I want to hit home the fact that there is an assignment on your life. I asked some people when I was teaching, was Jesus fully human? And they said yes. And I said, but he never fornicated.
I said, mind that.
Jesus never had a girlfriend.
Christo no nimpna.
Or you know what intelligent response he offered? But we cannot trace all that Jesus did in the Bible. So it could happen that Jesus had a girlfriend, but it wasn't recorded. This is the wisdom of the devil. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
That Jesus had a girlfriend, but they decided not to record what he did secretly. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
And I said, no, if you want to find out, go beyond the Bible. There is a historian called Josephus. Read the accounts of Josephus and you get to know the full import and the life of Jesus. I want to encourage you. It is possible to remain holy and pure till you marry. It is possible to remain holy and pure before you marry. The teachings of Jesus should put boundaries and restrictions on your activities. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Then number two. The yoke of Christ
means
doing his will and his work. Move to point four. The yoke of Christ is what? Doing his will and his work. I'll come and talk about it. Then the yoke of Christ means to submit to the ordinances of Christ. Say with me, submit to the ordinances of Christ. The yoke of Christ is to submit yourself. Say with me, the yoke of Christ is to submit yourself to the ordinances of Christ. What do I mean by that? Go with me to Acts chapter 4. And even go to Hebrews 10:25. Hebrews 10 says, do not stop assembling yourselves together. Hebrews 10, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Coming to church means you are submitting to the order of Christ. It means you are submitting, you are yielding yourself to the ordinances of Jesus. Because Jesus went to the synagogue.
Jesus,
he went to church. Don't tell me that going to church is optional. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Church going, you can't force it on me.
I'm sorry, they won't mean me.
It's a choice and it's a decision. No, a person who bears the yoke of Christ. Going to church is not optional thing.
So sorry, no.
It becomes a command and a marching orders to apply your life to. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
Your amen is not sanctified.
Amen or form. Amen or
form. Ordinances of Christ. One is about the doctrines of baptism. You must allow yourself to be water baptized. It is an ordinance of God. Joining Christian fellowships. How many of you are part of the women's ministry? Some of you are not coming because, Pastor, I don't have time. I wish to come, but I have no time. The ordinance of Christ, if you are part, there's a Muslim here. And she will tell you, when it's time to perform Salah, look at me, Salah, you perform it 5 times a day. You have the fajo. What do you have again? You have the zoo. We have the
asa.
You have the isha. We have the magreb. The isha is the last one. And we have what is called
magreb.
There are time intervals between the 5 compulsory prayers. The first one begins at 5, between 5 and 5:30 early in the morning. Listen to me, I am teaching you something. 5:30 early in the morning, you hear the Islamic siren. You hear the siren calling all Muslims to wake up and prepare for encounter with Allah. Then after a few minutes, another person goes to give another call to prayer. After that call to prayer, every Muslim should stop whatever he's doing and attend to your appointment with Allah. How many of you here have time to pray even in the mornings? How many of you? Yesterday I said we are coming for morning prayer between 7 and 9. Most of you run away. An African man will say, you think you're doing your pastor. Come 7 to 9, we are out of the place. Some of you decided you will never come. In Islam, if you fail to perform one aspect of prayer, you will have to do it before the day is end. 5 compulsory ones. If you observe 3, you have death too. If you observe 4 remaining ones, it's a death ahead of you. And do you know what they do? The rudiments, the things they go through. Look at me. Sometimes you raise your hands. You look to the sky. You look straight downwards. You put your right hand over your left on your chest. Sometimes you bow down. You behave like you are squatting. You go through a lot of processes. Just sleeping or lying on your bed to pray. You need somebody with the cane to shift the demons out of you. Are you a serious Christian? Are you ready to bear the yoke of Christ? Muslims are bearing the yoke of
Allah.
Nikonia. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
But you, what are you doing? Bearing the yoke of Christ. Come to women's ministry. Come to youth ministry. Pastor, me, I will come provided that when it's time we will close. You'll be the first person to come late. After coming late, you want them to close at the agreed upon time. And some of you have a lot of excuses to offer. One day, when the trumpet sounds, with that simple excuse, you will never be raptured. With excuses, you may excuse yourself from rapture. Always you're giving excuses. You hear that trumpet, pa, it's time to go. Then you tell the angel, excuse me, I left my money behind. That simple excuse you will give to the angel, and by the time you fetch your money, rapture has ended. May God have mercy on his church. May God have mercy on his church. We must embrace the ordinances of Christ. Another ordinance of Christ is the Lord's Supper. Hear me and look at me. The Lord's what? Supper is a religious ordinance. It's a spiritual sacrament. It's a holy thing before God. I've seen a lot of people who run away from church when it's time for the Lord's Supper. You are not a committed Christian. Come come and dine with your daddy, you go into hiding. Why? I said, Pastor, I'm unclean. I'm unclean. That same person prays to God for deliverance. With that uncleanness, you talk to God and He hears you. But coming to dine with Him, you remembered that you were unclean. The Lord's Supper is also not an optional thing for the church. It is not optional. It is a requirement.
Yeah, I said, yeah.
Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
I want to end by giving us 6 examples of the yoke of Christ that we must bear as a church. 6 examples of the yoke of Christ. 6 examples of the yoke of Christ. I will read all the 6 and then we will read the 2 scriptures and we close. The first yoke is the yoke of seeking and saving the lost. Say with me, seeking and saving the lost. There's a scripture there for you. Luke 19:10. The which amongst you have 100 sheep, and if one should get missing, would not leave the 99 and go in search of the one that is lost? So the ministry and the yoke of Christ is to be seeking for lost souls. Souls that are perishing, souls that are going to hell. Brothers and sisters, we partner with, yet they don't know Jesus. Some of them are our friends, others are our business partners, but they don't know Jesus. Some of them are our next door neighbors, we share the same house, but they don't know Jesus. Some of them are in our environment, they don't know Jesus. We must seek and search for the lost souls and bring them to Christ. Somebody need to respond to that. Yoke number 2. The yoke of restoring backsliding saints to Christ. Restoring who? The yoke of restoring backsliding souls to Christ. Saints. People who were once on fire for God. But now church going has become a tag of war. Church going has become a tag of war. Why you tell them, let's go to church? So, come for me next week. Come for me next 2 weeks. If you should tell the same person, Charlie, there's a wedding around this area. I say, give me 30 minutes, okay? Wedding. Give me 30 minutes.
Yes,
I will go change and join you. But if you should tell the person, let's go to church. I don't have clothes for church. All my clothes are tattered. I don't even have a footwear. You know, church these days is money. I don't have offerings to give. God have mercy and help us. Go and restore backsliders to Christ. Today, people don't feel like the days of old. When somebody is backsliding, it doesn't affect you. We don't think much of our brothers who will die and go to hell. It's each one for himself, God for us all. So if you don't want to go to church, it's your own cup of tea. Somebody prayed and sought after you before you became born again. And you must follow up and seek for backsliders. Yoke number 3. The yoke of leading God's lamp to maturity in Christ.
So would you
leading God's young or God's lamb to maturity in Christ.
So would you Christ
these things we are going to convert it into Sunday school lessons.
Listen to me.
There are people who are weak in the Christian faith. They are like lambs. Every little problem, he goes back to the world. There are people who don't understand a lot of things we do in Christianity.
So
if God is aware that I need this, why should I be praying to him? I mean, why should we even pray to God at all? If God is really God, why should evil be happening in our world? So there are people who are too infantile, they are immature. It is the duty of you and I to help them to grow together in the Christian faith.
You
must help them to grow in the Christian faith. Yoke number 4. The yoke of building the church of Jesus Christ.
Say
with me, building this church for God. Building this church for God. How many of you believe that KPIGC is a church of God? It's a church born by God. How many of you believe that this church is a true church from God? Then we have a responsibility. We have a burden. We have a ministry and a mission. To build the church of Jesus Christ. He says, I will build my church on this rock. That rock was Peter. But now Peter is no more. Who is stepping into the shoes of Peter? To become the foundation upon which God wants to build his church. If you call for prayer ministry, people don't want to respond. Evangelism, people don't want to respond. Singing, people don't want to respond. Come and usher in the church. We are not responding, so we don't want to build the church. But building the church is a responsibility that should be borne by Christians. I need your amen to that. 4, 5. The yoke of making the kingdom of this world become the kingdom of Christ. Brother, the yoke of making the kingdom of this world become the kingdom of Christ.
Because
there are kingdoms. We must make the kingdoms of this world become the kingdom of our
God.
Islam is a kingdom. Buddhism is a kingdom. Hinduism is a kingdom. Vikanka is a kingdom. So we must make the kingdoms of this world become the kingdom of our God. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
Now read Revelation 11:15 for me. And see what is there. Revelation 11:15. Then we take the last two scriptures.
Now you have to read some.
Revelation.
Johannes did some woman.
And the seven angels sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Johannes did some. It's too bad. Kunyumu dunu mne say. Now, above what Otoson son is sending to Trobento. Now, and near I can see a JJ, so to say. We are seeing him near Ayan, a brother, Nikisto Nitia. Now, obedient him, da. Amen.
Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
The sixth one is the yoke of planting more churches. The yoke of planting more churches. Churches. According to Genesis 49:22.
Genesis 49:22.
And then John 15:5. Joseph is a fruitful bough and his whose branches run over the wall. So we should have more branches, more churches for Christ. Let's all rise up. Let us all rise up. Everybody should stand to his feet. Take your Bible with you in your hands.
We
want to read the two scriptures.
And
then we pray for Matthew 25:31-40. Matthew 25, reading from 31 to 40. I want you to look on the projector if you don't have a Bible. Go with me verse by verse so that we can. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations. And he shall separate them one from another as a shepherd divided sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come ye blessed of my father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundations of the world. For I was hungry and ye gave me meat. I was thirsty and ye gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. Naked and ye clothed me. I was sick, you visited me. I was in prison,
ye
came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer and say, Lord, when saw we thee and hungered, and fed thee, or thirsty and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger and took thee in? Or naked and clothed thee? Or when saw so we thee sick or in prison and we came unto thee? And the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done this, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. The king shall answer and said unto them, the king or Jesus shall answer and say unto Kingdom Parish, Jesus shall answer and say to Pastor John, Jesus shall answer and say to somebody standing, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done this unto one of the least of my brethren, you have done it unto me. Church, I want you to listen. What are you doing in this time of your life towards somebody who has backslidden? What are you doing? What ministry are you carrying towards somebody who don't know Jesus? Somebody who doesn't have a relationship with God. He says, as you did for them, you have done it for me. If you neglect those people, you have neglected Jesus. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
Let this message go deep into your heart. You may have come to this service with your personal vision and your personal desire. You were expecting a different message, but God knows the season best, and he desires that you should hear this message. Somebody's salvation is counting on you. Somebody's deliverance is counting on you. Somebody to be restored to the Christian faith is counting on you. God is waiting on you to be a vessel that he will use to bring others to Christ. And as we close this service and go back to our various destinations, may we carry the bones of becoming passionate about souls that are dying. Somebody needed, if you are with me, to respond. You needed to have responded. One day when the trumpets are sound, it will take us by surprise. The very sermon you don't want to hear will be the very word God will use in Jesus. That you sat and you heard me preach and preach and preach, but your heart was too hard for me. You have a stiff necked attitude towards my words. So when my servant preaches to you, you go out and you spit it out of your mouth. You go out and you are like, it's too bitter for me to swallow. The sermon is too bitter for me. You spit it out. But if you will take this same message, look into yourself. Examine your time. What do you do for God with your time? Some of you are like, when my time is up, I will do it. We are playing on the engine time. The full 90 minutes has been exhausted. We are living on an engine time. So you have no time again to waste. Pastor, my time is not up.
So for me,
I'm waiting when my time is due. Then I will be a powerful preacher.
You
will never have the time you are waiting for. So you need to start today. Be more passionate about souls. Be concerned about the destinies that are going to hell. Look at Kingdom Parish and where God has placed the church. People have been running double services every Sunday. But there are people who come to church and say that we want to be worshiping with you the rest of our lives. Hallelujah. You put your hands together. Let's give a clap offering to Jesus. You think ministry is all about clapping. You finish clapping and you never take the person's telephone number to look for him or her. Just last week, two people joined the church. Where are they? It shows the attitude of the members. Two people joined the church. We raise, oh hallelujah. Put your hands together for Jesus. You clap for them.
Boy and Samsa.
Where are they today?
And no more.
Who knew their address?
One in
Who has their telephone numbers?
One in from
that of your fiancé. If he were your fiancé, so if he were your boyfriend.
So
you
won't plan.
Even when you get a new sim, you want to look for another phone to get the telephone number of your so-called fiancé.
A
member comes to church and you are careless, you are adamant, you are indifferent. You don't mingle, you don't share. As soon as church closes, you have also closed. You pick your bag and luggage. You go. No association, no fellowship. You have no time for that nonsense in church. You have friends at the Keep Faith Centers and the MyBed.com and the football and other entertainment centers. You have people there you spend time and you waste time with. Eternity is counting on us. Ladies and gentlemen, eternity is counting on us. You doze off, I'm preaching to you. Eternity is counting on us. The time is already past. We cannot continue to be sitting on our toes. We cannot bury our hands in between our thighs. We cannot continue to offer the same excuses all the time. Pastor, I don't have time. One day you wake up and your boss is dead. You see that you sacked from the business because a new king arose and he had nothing to do with Joseph and his descendants, and he began to maltreat the children of Israel. One day the tables were set and things will be over. The things you are so much dependent on that you don't want to respond to the call.
It will
be over one day.
One
day you go to bed and you never wake up. One day you tell your brother, shall I meet you tomorrow early in the morning? They will be knocking your door and you could hardly hear. Why? Eternity has bailed on you. The bell of eternity has rung on you. And so you cannot wake up. You hear people crying and they are screaming. You wish you could come back. You wish you could resurrect. You wish you could be given another chance. Brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, we don't have time to waste. The scripture says, today is not for us, let alone counting on tomorrow. You cannot be postponing the work on your life till tomorrow. You cannot continue to be giving excuses. One day you will lie down. You close your eyes. Your hands become stiffened. Your legs are all dry. Your heart will not have the ability to work again. Your blood flow will cease. The owner of the bread will take away his bread. Look at when I'm preaching, others are even chewing gum. Nom, nom, nom. Pastor, what are you talking about? Let me chew away the message. Nom. What is that? What is so much about heaven?
Heaven cried any day.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen.
I know what is there. That is why I'm struggling and I'm suffering and I'm sweating to let you know. Because the world has blinded some of your eyes. Money has blinded your eyes. You are like a person wearing a magnificent glass. You don't see well. When you wear a magnificent glass, you don't see well. And some of you, you are not seeing well. Because of the spectacle you are wearing. You look to the world and you are like, it will never come to an end. You finish eating and you are actually a zibano yese.
Deborah,
a time will be there. Food will be placed by you. You not have a hand to dig into the
bowl.
A time will dawn on you. All the clothes you have gathered. You turn back and you look at your clothes. It's a waste of energy. King Solomon says, vanity upon vanity. Wasted my time. I've wasted my energy. All the money at the bank. The bankers will not even give them to your relatives. You go to the bank and they tell you, if indeed you have a relationship, we need documents to testify. Those banks, they are morally corrupt. You save your money and you die. And sometimes it could take about 2 years, 3 years. And the money has not been released. You go there today and they tell you, come the following day. You go the following day and they tell you, there's a system, there's a network problem. We cannot access your account. Kindly go and come. That go and come alone will put a stop on you. Let them take the money. Vanity upon vanity. You are going to hell. Somebody is enjoying the labor, the fruit of your labor. When you hear his voice today, do not harden your heart. When you hear his voice today, do not harden your heart. I want you to pray. Bow your heads. want you to pray. It's about heaven. It's about eternity. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus is coming soon. He is at the door. He is at the door. Can you give me that song? He is at the door. Standing at the door. Calling on you. My daughter, come to me. My son, come to me. I have a reward for your labor. I have a reward for your labor. Come to me, my son. Come to me, my daughter. I want to give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Do the work of an evangelist. Do the work of a soul winner. Visit people who have backslidden. Go from houses to houses. Encourage people to come back to Christ. Go and share with them the gospel of Christ. Be an encouragement to a backsliding soul. God is calling you, my brother. God is at the beck and call of your life. Calling people to respond. He has everything you will ever need. Talk about money.
Zika.
Talk about silver and gold. Talk about relationships. Talk about pleasures. He has everything for you. He is your healer. He is your deliverer. Even if you are sick, he will heal you free of charge. He will deliver you. He will prepare you. And he will equip you. Just listen to the song and let us pray.
And you mean you ask Christ to have a prunity now of frail?
Someone's calling out your name.
Oh, people with the ATM of frail.
Calling time and time again.
I pray you now.
Can you hear him calling?
What is that of frail?
Can you hear him calling?
What's in the name? Run off, run, what's it?
He's been calling very long.
The piata.
He's been calling for so long.
What flower check?
Can you hear him calling?
What's in the nest of Rana?
He's been calling.
What does so afraid? Christ, what is the opportunity of friend,
Lift up your hands.
The one better was a pastor.
He's at the door.
Pray to God.
Vampire.
I want to respond.
Same person, me just so.
That Lord, I'm starting right from today. I'm going to look for people who are backslidden. Lord, I want to be an intercessor. I want to pray for people that they will know Jesus and know him well. 2018, I want people, I want members.
So, I feel with all people, microphone in sorry man.
Want to be an intercessor?
You
want to join the intercessor ministry?
That
we will pray for our heads break off. We will pray till we vomit blood. We are ready. Open up the door of your heart. Lord, send us around the world with the news of your saving power. Send us around the world with the news of your saving power. Send us around the world with the news of your saving grace. Send us around the world. The recounting of our lives is much more important than the call. Send us around the world. We have only one life to live. We have only one life to share. Jesus came and shared his only life for us. He is expecting that we also share our lives for him. Who is ready to share? Who is ready to share? Who is ready to be sent? Who is ready to be used? Who is ready to be prepared and to be trained by God? Who is ready to be trained by God? Surrender your life. Dedicate your life to him. If you know something is blocking you from fellowshipping with Jesus, rapture may happen even after today. What would that man, that boy, that sister, that girlfriend, that relationship, what would he do for you? Surrender your life to Jesus. Surrender your life. And lift up your hands. I pray that the Holy Spirit will arrest some of you.
Amen.
To respond to the call of God.
Amen.
I pray that the heavens will open.
Jesus.
And that the burden of the Lord will rest heavily on our heads.
Amen.
May the burden of the Lord rest heavily on our hearts.
Jesus.
May we receive that burden of the Lord.
Amen.
The burden of God. May the Holy Spirit minister. Arrest the attention of somebody. Arrest your heart.
And for your coma domum,
arrest your soul,
and for your cry,
and the rest of your life,
and the Nipedia, and the young Quanina
receive the desire,
sir, or Peno and Mumraye,
receive the desire,
sir, or Peno and Mumraye,
receive the call,
sir, or Freno and Ramaye,
receive the burden,
sir, Unconriano and Ramaye.
Somebody lift up your hands and be present
in San Costro.
Father, by your eternal fire and spirit,
Jesus,
visit this service this morning.
Amen.
Let your eternal fire and spirit be rekindled.
Jesus.
Let your spirit rekindle the fires,
Jesus,
that will cause us to risk our lives.
Amen.
To risk everything,
Jesus,
not counting so much,
Jesus,
that we will fulfill your call.
Amen.
Let there be a holy desire, Lord.
Jesus.
Meet us.
Amen.
Affect us.
Amen.
Influence us.
Amen.
Break us.
Jesus.
Mold us. Fill us.
Amen.
And begin to use us.
Amen.
In the quietness of your heart.
Jesus.
The Holy Spirit will start ministering to some of you. It will be a touch. It will be a strong edge.